Members, we have a quorum now, so I call the meeting to order. Before I proceed, I have to deal with two motions moved last time. We proceed to voting right away. And we have a motion moved by Ms. Starry LEE, another one moved by Mr. SHIU Ka-chun. Both are related to the payment for the examination fees for school candidates sitting for the 2020 Hong Kong DSE examination. The motions have been sent to members, and I don't want to. I don't think there's a need to read them out again. It's been the first motion. It's been projected on the screen. It's the one moved by Ms. Starry LEE. For those in favor, please raise your hands. Those against, please raise your hands. Abstention. I think the majority of members are in favor of this motion, so it's passed. The second one is moved by Mr. SHIU Ka-chun. And please see the screen for the contents. Mr. Ma Feng Kuo, do we need to handle the motion if the mover is not with us? In accordance with past practice, at the panel level, yes, we can. Actually, Ms. Starry LEE is also not with us now. But those in favor, please raise your hands. Those against, abstention. All right, so the majority of members are in favor of the motion, so this motion is passed. Ms. Starry LEE, your motion has already been passed. A paper has been issued since the last meeting. That is a letter from Mr. Jimmy Ng on his proposed St. John's College Amendment Bill 2019. So far, we have received no comment on the bill. Items for discussion for the next meeting. The next meeting will be held on the 14th of June 2019. It's a Friday. We'll start at 10:45. We have three proposed items. And the first one is on the proposed arrangement to notify applicants applying for secondary school places under the self-application stage. Second item, for vocational and professional training. The third one, the school parent cooperation and parent education. This is about a report produced by the Task Force on Homeschool Cooperation and Parent Education. And we're going to have a joint meeting with the Welfare Services Panel on the 28th of May at 9:30 to discuss the speech therapy services for the elderly, the disabled, and SEND students. And in September, we're going to have a duty visit to Finland. It will be in the second week of September. We're going to visit Helsinki and another city of Finland. So we'll be able to see the education system in the capital as well as in another city of the country. Details will be sent to members in due course, and you'll be invited to indicate whether you're going to go or not. So we would come to a decision very soon. If you have, well, we would invite members to a discussion if there are further issues to tackle. So we'll now move on to item number 4 of the agendas, enhance support measures for schools to cater for students with special educational needs and propose members' bill on special educational needs. Let's invite the officials to join us. And please raise your hands if you want to speak on this item. This item is related to a legislative proposal. All members of the council have been invited to join us in our discussion. The bill, the Special Education Needs Bill proposed by Mr. Dennis Guo and Dr. Fernando Zhang, and also the a document on supporting students with SEND policy recommendations have been sent to members, and we have also have some background information provided by the Secretariat. Now that the officials have been seated, may I invite Mr. Kelvin Young, Secretary for Education, to brief us on the government's paper, and then I will invite Mr. Dennis Kwok and Dr. Fernando Zhang to introduce their bill. Members and the officials will be given 3 minutes to speak. Secretary? Well, Chairman, we have been adopting a dual-track mode in providing special education for the students with severe or multiple disabilities. We will refer them to special schools. As for other SEND students, they would attend ordinary schools. The number of students is 8 to 15 for special schools, and apart from the normal teacher to student ratios, there will be additional teachers provided for special education. So SHIU ratio is a 1 to 2.5 to 1 to 5.4, and we also provide other professional support. It's at a ratio of 1.17 to 1.43. This term government has introduced new measures to help special educations. For example, they provide the provision of a new postcard SEND call, the provision of speech therapies and occupational therapies, and increasing manpower in of social worker and nurses. So make sure that there will be at least one school social worker in schools with fewer students. And for administrative staff, manpower enhancement, special education would also be assisted. Apart from children with moderate intellectual disability, the provision of hostels are on the whole adequate. In terms of manpower, starting from 2014-2015 school year, we have increased the manpower of some special schools. We continue to communicate with the sector to roll out more enhancement measures. On the other hand, for ordinary schools in the public sector, we are providing professional training and teacher training so as to promote the whole school approach. In 2017-2018, after consultation, and listening to stakeholders on integrated education. And we have also looked at the PAC and the Audit Commission's recommendations starting from 2019-2020 school years. There will be new measures to ensure that there will be a stable teaching force and they can utilize resources and professional support more flexibly so as to further enhance the effectiveness of education. There will be learning sports background, and integrated teaching schemes for primary schools. And this would be the third tiered allowance would be doubled. For schools admitting more SEND students, we would upgrade the rank of the SEND call, and we also roll out the school-based psychological service and also school-based speech therapist service for the primary and secondary schools in the public sector are meeting more SEND students, more non-ethnic Chinese students will provide more support and send students have access to equal opportunities in education as they are protected by the racial discrimination or the equal opportunities or legislation. We'll continue to roll out enhancements. These areas of work are regarded as priority areas. We believe that with the new measures and initiatives implemented, we will be able to upgrade the quality of special education continually.
Thank you, Secretary. I'd like to call upon the sponsors of the bill, Mr. Dennis Kwok and Dr. Fernando Zhang, Chairman. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk about this private members bill. We've been spending 6 years on this. We've consulted the frontline volunteers and parents, and also the special education organization on this. The primary objective of the private bill is to seek an equal learning opportunity and write this into the law and codify the arrangement. Otherwise, the parents and students will not be able to enjoy equal opportunities for education, and a lot of measures will not be properly implemented. There will be measures like early identification, early intervention, support of special education and IEP, individualized education program, and also an appeal mechanism. All these measures are intended to enable the SEN students in mainstream schools to get accustomed to the learning environment and benefit from the system. The information, the system is not transparent enough. Parents and social workers will find it very difficult to get hold of objective information about special education. 6 years ago, when we started studying the subject, the administration was reluctant to provide for SENCO. Today, we're pleased to see that the administration has implemented the SENCO, and it has also regularized this arrangement. So a lot of the aspirations are legitimate, are justified, and they should be implemented. The government should implement the individual education plan as soon as possible. Finally, there is going to be an appeal mechanism. The students do not enjoy equal opportunity for education. They have no redress whatsoever. They approach the education department, but they are shuffled around different departments. And there are loads of examples of this kind. Why is it that SEN students would have to face so many difficulties? Isn't it right for us to help the SEN students to facilitate their education, to assimilate them into the learning environment? This is the whole purpose of the bill. Back in 1994, the mainland of China has already implemented such a bill. In 1996, Macau has done likewise. Why is it that Taiwan, the mainland, and Macau can do it and Hong Kong cannot? And this is really mind-boggling. Thank you. Chairman. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about this private members bill. And we started from scratch. We don't have any existing legislation to go by. We have a very detailed policy, a very detailed paper on policy analysis. I hope the members would have a look at this. The legal basis and also the discussion in the community have been going on for so many years. Some of them are very specific, like Mr. Dennis Kwok said. We want a SENCO in each and every special school. The government didn't see the need for that, but in the course of legislation, or drawing up the legislation, we saw that the government has changed tack. Early intervention, early identification, these are important principles. Now, we do have the guidelines in the legislation for early identification and intervention to be implemented. It is important to codify these. There are mechanisms that are in place at the moment. Without any legal backing, it may not be able to be achievable. I don't want to take up too much of members' time, except to say that we are serious in our drafting of the bill. The bill has been given the certificate of the DOJ. Technically, it is totally feasible. What we are waiting for is members' support and the government's endorsement. If the administration would like to go down this path and enact the legislation, then it would be all the better. We'd like to see this happen and appeal to for members' support in this regard. We're going to move two motions in the course of the meeting. All right, thank you very much for the two members. This is a bill compiled in earnest. There are seven members who have indicated their intention to speak. And there are two more. I read out your names. Michael Tin, Michael Luk, Leung Yu-chung, myself, Holden Chow, Ching Chung Tai, Leung Chi-chung, Ray Chen, Rebecca Chen, and more else, Fernando Zhang. There are total 10 members. I suppose that 4 minutes for each member. I've drawn a line there. So 4 minutes for those members. If you want to take the floor for the second time, you may not get 4 minutes. Mr. Michael Tin, integrated education has been going on for 20-odd years, 18-19 in primary and secondary schools, and 9%, 8% have SEN students. For teachers who have undergone training, 30 to 40% or thereabout. My understanding is that for integrated education, they want SEN students to be integrated into the classrooms. For these 8% or 9%, it doesn't make sense for them to be concentrated in one single class and to be taught by SEN-trained teachers. So these 30-40% may need to increase to 80-90%. You need to have the whole teaching force with SEN training. So will the training be 3-4 months? If we want to have to be true to the spirit of special education and scattered the SEN students to each class, maybe 8-9% in each class. And if the training course is shorter, then it would make sense. I'm not sure whether we will be able to achieve that if the training is for a prolonged period of time. Secretary? Chairman, we do need to provide training for teachers. For the past 20 or so years, we've been providing training for teachers. Now, for newly joined teachers, they have undergone some training in relation to SEN. So these new teachers do have a certain amount of understanding about SEN. So it is compulsory, isn't it? Yes, some of the elements are compulsory to cater for the differential abilities. There are three levels. We have the advanced course and the thematic course. They range from 30 to 120 hours of each course. 30 to 120 hours. It depends on the courses. For advanced thematic courses, and they might take a little bit longer, but basically it is 30 hours. We have a target every few years. The latest target is in 2019-20. We hope to achieve a certain target, a certain percentage for primary and secondary schools. And in the subsequent years, depending on the circumstances, we will set the targets for the coming years. In the long run, with integrated education, we hope that all the teachers would have some knowledge about SEN students. Each year, we may have a varying number of SEN students, and the categories may vary, but they do need to undergo different training. So your objective is to achieve 100% training for the newly joined teachers. There are no problems. Do you have any timetable for the serving teachers to bring them the number up to 100%? Every few years, we would upgrade the number. It would depend on the circumstances. I think we do need a little bit more time for the new recruits. We haven't included them in the percentage, so we need to have a closer look at these. Mr. Michael Look, I'm sure SEN students are very dear to our heart. We hope that they will have an equal opportunities when they grow up so that they can unleash their potential. I know that the government is intending to increase the educational psychologist and speech therapist in the system. Now you have educational psychologist shared between various schools. Is it possible for you to have one SBEP and SBST per school? I think there ought to be a close-knit team. Instead of having them scattered all over the place, it would take a year now for you to line up to see an educational psychologist. I'm wondering whether the Education Bureau has looked at the training now for educational psychologists and speech therapists. How can you make sure that there is a good match between the need and the availability? And also the third tier LSG, Learning Support Grant, the third tier has been multiplied, but what about the first and second tier? I think the LSG at different levels would serve different needs. For the first and second tier, maybe they're not that severe in their impairment, but if they can be given some assistance for them to catch up with the mainstream students and unleash their potential. I know that for some of the ADHD students, they are particularly creative and they have a lot of good ideas. Perhaps we can allow them to unleash their potential. Many parents are telling us that the LSG should become a system where money follows the people. The schools are putting a lot of emphasis on homework assistance, and with this across-the-board kind of system, it may not be sufficiently focused.
Some parents don't mind top up the cost by buying some accredited service from outside. So can we allow the money to follow the parents and they can spend the grant as they like? This is what I've been told by some SEN parent. And on Annex 2, on the about the categories, Appendix 2, there's some overlapping of the different types, SEN types. Can you report to us on the relevant data and also the ratio of these students compared to the total student population? Let me take the simple question first. We have actually removed any overlapping among the types. For example, if you have autism, the student may also have other special needs. So we would categorize according to the made issues, made needs. On the question of educational psychologists and speech therapists, we would move ahead one step at a time, depending on the development of the system. As for the three tiers of LSG, well, this is done through a whole school support approach. The grant is provided to the school to support these students instead of giving the money to individual to meet the needs of individual students. They may get a bigger or smaller grant, but the service provider will be professionally judged depending on the needs. So it's not a grant provided to students as such. Mr. Liang Yuchong, I believe back in the year 2000, I suggested in this council that the Education Bureau should pay more attention to SEND students. So some 19 years has passed, and we note the work done by the Bureau in the meantime, and the provision of more resources. And there are officials in the Education Bureau who are very dedicated to this. For example, Betty Yip, who would hold two meetings with us and with parents every year to find new and better ways to provide support to SEND students and to help them cope with education. In the past, they would only finish the primary education, and then they would be able to reach Form 3 and then secondary school. And some are now studying in tertiary institutions. We didn't have Sanko, now we have Sankos. And the year before last, I was glad to learn that some students will be able to sit the examination orally instead of deep writing. But have we resolved all the problems? Certainly not. 3 years ago, I, together with some parents, I visited Taiwan and met with some of the school organizations. Actually, there are some STEM students are very intelligent, and we should let them develop their full potential. This has been accomplished in Taiwan. They have many people in helping the SEND students in education. So some of the parents went with me said they would consider sending their children to Taiwan for better education. Why was Taiwan able to do that? Well, it's because they have laws. Four stakeholders, including schools, school sponsoring bodies, teachers, and parents, all are required to play a part. But of course, we are not saying that the law is the panacea. But if we have a piece of legislation on this, then the stakeholders know their roles and what they have to do. And the government would be more proactive in providing resources and in increasing manpower. So I support the two members' private bill. No one can say for sure whether after enactment the bill will solve every problem. But given the constraints we face, I believe the bill will give us the backup to do more. Because very often while we might want to do something, we are constrained by factors beyond our control. I talked to the secretary while he was the undersecretary about this. So I hope this build would be able to allow us to do more. So I'm not going to talk about enhancements and improvements that we should make. There are so many of them. But it's important that we help these SAN students to learn. In my school, there were two SAN students who were able to get science award, both in Hong Kong, in the mainland, and even in the US. They used to be low achievers, but some teachers nurtured them with dedication, and they were able to achieve that much. So if we have a piece of legislation to support special education, it's certainly very positive. I hope the government will give its support to the private bill sponsored by the two members. So that's my comments about this. Yes, I also want to pay my respects to the two members for coming up with this private bill. I would like to see the substantial improvement made in the future, because so far the outcome of integrated education is far below our expectation. We want to promote the education of SAN students in ordinary schools through this, but the outcome is not satisfactory. Not some SAN students are not well taken care of, and the learning environment in those schools has deteriorated. I hope the government will face up to the problems so that all SAN students will get good care, will be taken good care. It's important as a matter of education. So I support the private bill sponsored by the two members. And in the paper, paragraph 13, mention is made about the new measures, enhancement measures in special education. And that is the enhanced counseling under new approach. I note that there was no consultation. There were only some briefing sessions conducted. So schools generally felt that their views were not respected. I reflected their views to the government, and they responded by saying that these are just like enhancement measures and should not be a problem. The promise was there will be enhancements and improvements. Now I've received many complaints from schools. First thing, they didn't mention that there was a cap on the grant. And now they know there's a grant. However many, the number of SAN students you admit, the grant would be capped at a certain level. So what can those schools do if they have many SAN students? And compared with the old scheme, there will be additional manpower in the new scheme. But there's a setting off mechanism in terms of manpower enhancement in the new scheme, but not under the new scheme, not under the old scheme. We know we have the SAN co-posts created in schools in over the course of 3 years. Some school will do this in the third year. For the first and second year, there will be no problem. But for the third year, there will be setting off. And if you create a post in the following year, that you have some posts canceled. And in the past, they have some frozen posts to meet the needs, certain special needs. And now such posts will be offset. The CE talk about creating a more a stable learning environment and to deploy resources flexibly to meet SAN students' needs. How can the school environment or the teaching environment be more stable if some of them cannot have their contracts renewed or because of the knock-on effect? some contract teachers have to go after the expiry of the existing contracts. In the word of some school principals, this is actually a fraud. So I hope that some better measures can be worked out with the schools. My time is up, but I think this. Well, let me. I have to say something. I think the chairman has not depicted the full picture, but I don't have time to speak on this. Suffice to say that we'll continue to liaise with and talk to the schools and the school principals. Mr. Houghton Chow. The government should come up with appropriate policies and measures for special SEND students. Paragraph 14 is on the new arrangement for LSG, Learning Support Grant. All the primary and secondary school, ordinary primary and secondary school in the public sector will be benefited. For Tier 3, the LSG grant rate, it would be increased from the current 2 times to 4 times the rate of Tier 2 support. There are schools running the old scheme, IRTP, and they have an additional teacher for remedial teaching. And if they change to this new grant system, would they suffer the loss of that additional teacher? Or is it that you are going to provide a sufficient amount of grant so that the grant can be used to hire additional teacher? So that's my first question. Second question is on paragraph 17, Special Educational Needs Coordinator SANCO. In 1819, 544 public sector ordinary schools have this provision for SANCO. The remaining will follow in 2019-2020 school year. The SANCO has to handle the educational work. Can the SANCO really be dedicated to special educational needs coordination? I need to know the current state of affairs, because SANCO, in my view, plays an important part in this sector. I thank you for your the members' questions. First, on SANCO post, in the coming school year, all schools will be provided with the SANCO post. If the number of SEND students reach a certain level, they will have an upgraded SANCO post. In terms of work arrangement, we would like the SANCO to dedicate 70% of the time to the SEND's education-related duties.
We need to keep the teaching experience as well, because what they are thinking about would be relevant to the teaching. So we do want to maintain some teaching experience for them. Now, coming back to the LSG, to replace the IRTP, Intensive Remedial Teaching Program. Now, once a school has adopted the LSG, as long as they hit $60,000, 36 When they hit $600,000, $360,000 would be deducted and allow them to create a regular teaching post. The $360,000 would be the basic salary. They would end up with more money to play with. Now, with this scheme, we're going to add an additional 1,000 teaching posts compared with the existing supplement or complement. Now, for those affected by the IRTP, we do have measures for them, and there will not be any offsetting arrangement for Senko. We do have a lot of details. If we have time, I'm prepared to explain in greater depth. But all in all, there will not be a direct impact on the teachers. Dr. Ching Chung-tai, Chairman, thank you. There are two members, Dr. Fan Lu Zheng and Mr. Dennis Kwok, moving this special education needs bill. I'd like to hear from the Education Bureau their views regarding this bill. How likely is it that they will endorse this bill and so on? Now, Dr. Zheng and Mr. Kwok move this bill. The second part, part two, there is a definition for special education. And there is a difference between what the government intends to define it. There are eight different parts to the government's definition, but in this bill, it is more liberal in its approach. So will the administration tell us their views regarding this definition? If this definition is going to be adopted, how will the Education Bureau deal with it? Second, there is also a mention of the IEP, Individual Education Plan. Now, in absence of this bill, will the Education Bureau tell us whether they have any intention to implement this idea of IEP? And if they are not going to implement this, what difficulties are they encountering, Secretary? Chairman, as I said before, my personal view is that going down the legislative path will not be the answer to the whole problem. I think the whole community should spend a little bit more time to see how we can improve special education. More endorsement in the community, more publicity would be far better than having a bill. We will, however, look at the details of the bill. For the eight categorizations, we categorize them in accordance with the services provided. It is in line with the international community in terms of definition. Now, the member said that the bill is more liberal in its approach. I think we have to look at the underlying philosophy and the effectiveness. If there are other categories that should be included, we are prepared to consider it, like mental illness or students with a mental illness. We have incorporated them into the system. Depending on the needs of the community, we would take the decision accordingly. The second issue is the IEP. Right, individual education plan. In our third tier service, we have made it mandatory for the schools to put together an IEP. For the first and second tiers, we also require the schools to come up with some plans, although it is not a formal IEP. In many areas, we feel that other than the third tier, which is more severe, for the other tiers, we may not necessarily need such detailed education plan in a formalized manner. In other jurisdictions, there are examples to show that an IEP would be in the form of a document. Will we be devoting too many resources to putting together the plan at expense of care? We have to consider this. Mr. Leung Chi Chung, Chairman. I think that the parents are most concerned about the special education needs. I read somewhere that there are about 9,000 who are on the queue for special education. covering different categories. So like the Secretary said, if we focus our resources on providing the care, it would be far more efficient than going down the legislative path. I'm not saying that I don't support the legislation, but if the government can provide more support for special education, it would be far more important. First, there is a shortage of school places for SEN students. Will the Education Bureau make up for this shortfall? Second, we have the integrated education. Allow me to say we are integrating the ASEAN students with the mainstream counterparts. And we are offering them individual support, and this is terribly important. In some cases, the parents would very much like to attend schools with their children. It's like some of the international schools, students can join the mainstream classrooms. Would the Education Bureau have some novel ideas? Now, the percentage is about 10%. I am sitting on the school council of some of the schools. It would be hard for us to give them individualized support. I know of a special school in Tuen Mun, and they are focusing on the needy students, and they are achieve pretty good results. And this school is very popular with parents. Are you going to be giving more support to these schools? They are a school like this is run on a private basis. Well, Mr. Long, the school that you refer to is not a special school. Maybe they have admitted more SEN students, and they can focus their attention more on the SEN students. Now, the underlying philosophy is that if students need specific care, like in a severe impairment situation, with the consent of the parents, and after professional assessment, and they can attend special schools where they will enjoy more intensive care. For other students, if we can provide more support and specific support, they can attend school in mainstream school places. That's why we have the idea of integrated education. If they are attending ordinary schools, then it would be more conducive to their development in society going forward. But we are prepared to consider the new ideas or a wide variety of different models, as long as the integrated education or special education will be helpful to the students. Mr. Ray Chen, Chairman, thank you. Chairman, I support the private bill moved prepared by Mr. Kwok and Dr. Zheng. I don't subscribe to the government's response. Now, the government is against the legislative proposal for IEP in paragraph 31. You have seen the response. They said that this is one of the response measures. It doesn't mean that we cannot make it compulsory. And second, they hide behind the school-based approach. They're saying that this would involve the school-based judgment, and they said that if we rigidly specify IEP, it may not be in line with the needs of individual schools. Now, for you to come up with this observation or this response, did you gauge the school's response? Do you have any preconceived ideas? If you do not increase the number of teachers and ask them to implement IEP, certainly they would have reservations because that would be straining the resources. So you ought to tell us how you conducted the consultation. I'm not sure whether we can call it consultation. But if the government is willing to increase the resources and manpower, they may have responded differently. Is it the case that we don't have enough resources? That if you don't have enough resources, then you can't go anywhere. But if you have the resources, it would be a matter of administration. Now, for the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, the Lantau's provision, you are prepared to increase the resources. Now, I don't think you have gone into that stage yet because you don't seem to agree with the overriding consideration. Now, with IEP, what drawbacks would there be so much so that you would be setting your face against this idea? Secretary, Chairman, our view is that we do have the IEP, we do have the requirement that for the third tier support, all students will be given an IEP. We do not stop school authorities implementing IEP where the situation warrants. So it would depend on the students' needs. And they will come up with a plan befitting the students' needs. It doesn't necessarily have to be an IEP. It can be some simple supportive model, like how can we talk with the students in a better way to enable them to concentrate more. But with IEP, if members have looked at it in detail, it would involve a formalized approach, and the teachers will have to fill out everything in sufficient detail. Now, what we are requiring is that for the first and second tiers, there is going to be a study plan, although not in the form of an IEP, but for the third tier, we do need to have a formalized IEP to make sure that they follow every step of the way. So if there is a need for the IEP and they're forced to do the IEP, the teachers would have to spend an awful long time because everyone will have to fill out the IEP form. And for simple cases, for the cases that are not so much in need, isn't it right to focus more attention on the care? Mr. Chen, I hope that you would give time to the sponsors of the bill to make a response. Ms. Rebecca Chen. Chairman, thank you. Now, according to the paper, the Education Bureau talks about early identification and early intervention, and we do need to identify the SEN students as soon as possible. You say you have to devote a lot of resources, training teachers, integrated education, help for the special needs students.
The Secretary doesn't think that legislation is going to help with every problem. I've been a legislator for just 6 months. I received many requests for assistance from SEN parents, especially those with ADHD. They think that the integrated education, which has been in place for 22 years, is not very helpful. They need to the SEN children have to get education, but they also need other help in growth. The golden age is from the age of 6 to 9. If they are put in an ordinary school, and you know that in terms of teacher training, and we have been given some figure in the special FC meetings, the ratio of teachers receiving the training in SCN has not risen, but we have seen an increase and a continuous increasing trend of SCN students. So without building more special schools, apart from IE, what more can you do to help SEN students and their parents so that they can get a good education or that suits their needs? We in terms of integrated education, how can we improve the education in the schools to help students with SEND? If these students can learn in ordinary schools, they should be put together with other students in the school so that they will be able to progress like other students. So we need to provide more support to the schools in order for them to do a better job. Every case is different. We have created the Senko Pose, and we organized other support measures such as LSG. We hope that this would stabilize the teaching force. We'll provide more professional support. More resources will be given, and more resources can be given to the schools so that they can improve the service provided. Although they are not yet working under an ideal system, they will continue to strive for improvements. For after 2019-2020, after the achievement of the milestone targets, we would look at teacher training again. We have many informal training, such as sharing sessions on seminars, so that they can learn from each other based on actual working experience. Some cases are difficult, which would require the involvement of more professional services. We also need the parents to cooperate. For example, medication. We can provide to some extent some healthcare services, but the parents must also cooperate by giving their children the medication prescribed punctually. Dr. Fernando Zheng, we all know that under the current education system, what you need to do is to get good marks. The students in the mainstream schools are under tremendous pressure, and the parent-children relationship is under stress. Many children have said that they don't have much time for leisure and for sleep. And so SEND students are under even worse conditions. Many teachers that do not have trust in IE, not that they do not subscribe to the concept. If we can provide a learning environment for the students with different abilities to grow together, then that's an idea that no one would object to. But if they are to be they'll be given intensive coaching so that they can do well in public examination, then students with learning difficulties are placed in the most disadvantageous position. The teachers and the team workers in schools are under a lot of pressure, because these students are supposed to be able to learn and progress so that they can lead a better life in the future. So we need, how can we make sure that these students with different learning abilities would be placed in a comparatively equaled learning environment? And in overseas countries, they do this through IEP, so as to narrow the gap between the different students, and the relevant stakeholders have to
take up some duties, some of the functions are to be discharged, and we have the law to back up the system. But the government is saying that we are doing this, but we are against a system that would require everyone to do this. I don't think we should argue over the wording or the concept. We share the same vision. We all want to move forward. We want to leave no student behind. And even if you do not want to legislate for this, but the implementation of IEP so that every student will get the right attention and be supported by professional teams. And also, in the parents and the students will be involved in the planning process so that the expectation and the information involved will be provided, will be communicated in a transparent manner. So soon we devote ourselves to the promotion of all these measures. As the member said, our education system has its own background or own culture. I have doubts as to whether we can legislate for something only because it's been done by other countries. Let's say, if some teachers do not subscribe to the idea of IE, would this be different if we have a law on this? What would be the outcome? Would it be better or worse? We have to carefully think it over. Apart from IEP, we also have support measures for other SAN students. There will be a support support plan summary for each SAN student. Four members would like to speak: Vincent Chan, Ms. Regina Yip, Ted Hoy, and then we have to handle four motions. We'll proceed to the vote. And Mr. Abraham Shack is unable to say anything today to speak on the bill today. He wants me to say that he supports the private bill. Mr. Winston Chang, many people are concerned about the needs of SAN students. I've been personally involved in this for some year, some 8 or 10 years ago. There was a lack of support for students with learning difficulties, and the waiting time with the Department of Health was very long. The different departments have devoted many resources. $2 billion in 2019-2018. I visited a special school with more than 1,000 students and saw for myself what have been carried out. So we have been providing resources. But there are three issues that we need to ponder over. For example, preschool support. The waiting time with the Department of Health is long. More people are aware of SAN problems. So there's a greater demand. More parents are trying to get the service for their children. So those people waiting for service are greater in number. We are doing quite a good job at the preschool level up to KG, but up when the student progresses to primary three, they have more the learning issues, learning problems, especially for those with ADHD or autism. At present, the teacher training, the teachers who have received training do not make up a lot of a high ratio of the total. And very often the support measures are sourced from outside the schools. So I would like to know what more can be done. The paper sets out what we have been doing or what we will be doing starting from 2019-2020. These measures will continue to be implemented. We have heard the views referred to by the member in the community. We'll come up with more focused response and measures. Mrs. Regina Yip, would you help a student with intellectual disability and with other special educational needs? I've been approached by many organizations, and I know that there's a need to have early identification. But as the Secretary has said, is this a problem that we can resolve if we have a piece of legislation or if we provide more resources? I think we should listen carefully to views from the teacher. I think that not many school principals and teachers have joined this alliance. The government has been generous, $8.3 billion in additional funding and more teaching posts. There are some consequences. For example, there will be an additional or two school social workers, but there are teachers doing counseling who are not trained as social workers. They would have to go. And then there will be administrative staff. And there is also the school librarian staff who are complaining about lack of resources and support. If we enact this bill and that provides for a new system, what would happen? Would those not giving the resources be complaining? It's just like the application of the Parkinson's law. So the New People Party have some reservation about this. I think the government shares Mrs. Regina Yip's concern. When we implement a new law, we have to anticipate the likely problems that may arise and the resources that we will need. Should we devote our resources to this new system, or should the resources be better deployed in other more useful areas? Such factors have to be carefully considered. Mr. Ted Hui, I'd like to say I support the private bill sponsored by Dr. Fernando Zhang and Mr. Dennis Kuo. Understand that there are three tiers of support under the IEP system to decide what kind of individual support should be given. But not everyone covered by the three tiers of support grant will be given an IEP. Many parents do not trust the categorizations done by the schools, and there's no redress mechanism for them.
So in the private bill, it seeks to respect the parents' right to lodge appeals. In the bill, it doesn't say that everyone should be given an IEP, but at least there is a channel for application. And there is an opportunity to make representation and adduce evidence, and this is making the whole process transparent, and there is going to be a platform for the parents for them to get redress in a formal way. So I think this is the spirit of enacting the bill. If I may put this to the administration, in the absence of this bill, how can you make sure that the parents will get redress? In paragraph 31, the response will be very important. In absence of enacting a bill, how else can the government achieve that? Secretary? At the moment, we don't have any specific bill or legislation on special education. Under the DTO, there is already some mechanism for appeal. In absence of this proposed bill, indeed, we receive from time to time cases referred to us. An education bureau will be following up on these cases on site. So for you to say that without the bill, we don't have any channel for appeal, the argument doesn't stand. Mr. Dennis Kwok, having listened so far, we haven't heard from the administration why, given so many parents and frontline teachers who are advocating for more resources and more support, the administration has not changed anything. Has the administration considered, instead of shifting the burden back to the school, will you really grapple the issue? So the teachers are of the view that the resources are insufficient and they are not able to achieve the purpose of integrated education. Given the shortfall of resources, is it right for the government to keep saying that they are implementing integrated education? Now, there are so many problems with that. Mr. Michael Tin referred to these problems, and he cited all these examples in his motion. And it was said that 3 to 9, ages 3 to 9, would be the golden opportunity for them to get support. And Dr. Ching Chung Tai also talked about the categorization of SEN. Shouldn't we be more aggressive in our definition? Now, in enacting a piece of legislation, there will be problems with implementation, but I heard from members that they are in support of this approach, given all these unpleasant and unfortunate incidents that are arising because there is a lack of support, there is a lack of commitment on the part of the government to the provision of special education. Secretary, well, he is saying that the government doesn't have the commitment. I must reject that. If you look at what the government has been doing over the years, in 2019, $8.2 billion have been set aside for special education and integrated education. And this represents the government's commitment and our care for the SEN students. Mr. Kwok made his points. Indeed, and there is a room for improvement in different areas, like how we can help the students in their golden period and how we can train up the teachers. We are debating, we're arguing the point that going down the legislative path may not be the answer to the problem. Rather, we should focus our attention on the care of these students. Right, let's get on with voting of the motion. There are 4 motions tabled in front of you. The first one is by Dr. Fernando Zheng. Mr. Zheng, will you please read out the motion, and then we put this to the vote. We have the quorum now. Chairman, this is about the LSG and the new measures. In order to improve the financial support, we urge the government to consult all the stakeholders and look at the LSG and provide improvement measures for schools that face curtailment of the LSG, and there should be more support for the schools so that the CEs are undertaking to provide for the SEN students will not be undermined. For those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against? Abstention. So obvious that the majority, that we have a majority for this motion. Motion is carried. The second motion is by Mr. Dennis Kwok and Dr. Fernando Cheung. Dr. Cheung, we urge the administration to legislate for special education as soon as possible so that the integrated education, special education can be implemented with statutory backing and every student will enjoy equal learning opportunity and will be more effective and necessary support for parents, teachers and the educationalists so that we can achieve the purpose of improving special education in Hong Kong. Right, there you are, those in favor. Please raise their hands. Those against? Abstention. All right, it's clear that we attained majority support and the motion is carried. The third motion is moved by Mr. Dennis Kwok. Supported by Dr. Fernando Cheung. Chairman, we urge the administration to set up a committee on special education as soon as possible so that there's going to be a platform for communication to discuss the solution and all the problems. Also, we can consolidate the government's policies and initiatives, and all the proposals can be looked into, and resources can be made available to mainstream and special schools to enhance the support for students, parents, teachers, and educationalists in order to achieve the purpose of improving special education. Those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against? Abstention. All right, we have majority support. Motion is carried. Last motion is moved by Mr. Michael Tin, please. Integrated education has been going on for 22 years, and the number of teachers who have undergone training represent 30 to 42%. And now these 30-hour training has been made available to teachers, and we urge the administration to, within 5 years, increase the proportion from 30 to 40% to a total 100%, so that all teachers responsible for SEN will be equipped with fundamental understanding. Those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against? Abstention. All right, then we have majority support, and again, the motion is carried. So much for this item, and let's move on to the next item. Progress in implementation of life planning education. So we invite the administration in, please. Members who intend to speak, please raise their hands. We have two members who so indicate, Mr. Ao Nok Hin and Mr. Leung Yu Jong. Regina Ip, Mr. Gary Fan, four members here on the list. Right, please so indicate if you intend to take the floor. I'd like to invite Under Secretary for Education, Dr. Choi Yuk-lin, to brief us on the paper. Chairman, from 2014-15, the Education Bureau has strengthened the support for schools to implement life planning education to help students to identify their interests, abilities, and orientations and at an earlier stage, and to get to grips with the career information and multiple pathways to make preparation for their further studies and career pursuits. In this regard, we have implemented a number of measures, like we have provided the career life planning grant and allow the option to convert the grant to regular teaching posts. We have also set up the district network. We also have the business school partnership to provide career exploration opportunities. We have conducted the first round of visit in 2014-15. We visited all the public and DSS schools to ascertain the situation, and we've also offered our input in regard to the school-based program. In 2017-18, we've started another round of school visit. The progress has been pretty good. Other than the variety of programs, the schools can also provide LPE education in the light of the school circumstances. And the LPE has been gaining traction in the community. There are 300 business organizations, community organizations who have become the BSPP partners and provide different career exploration activities, and they've gone down very well among the teachers and parents, and all the participating organizations also benefiting from that. We've also launched the website, the career information website. This has been open to the schools in 2018-19, and we are improving the career information website to turn it into a one-stop platform for timely dissemination and useful information to students, teachers, and parents. And also in 2016-17, we have developed the district development networks to consolidate all the local resources and enhance teachers' professional development and organize career exploration activities. This will be extended to all districts in Hong Kong. In order to consolidate the experience and chart the way forward, in August 2017, we have commissioned the Education University to review the effectiveness of LPE and the implementation of the policy and the benefits of BSPP on students. The findings of the review show that we are achieving early tangible results, and the schools have school-based policy to implement the LPE.
And more activities and more types of LPE activities. And these activities are well received by students and parents. And such activities are supported by organizations, partnering organizations. Although through career explorations and activities, they can learn more about different economic sectors and jobs. They may not have the skills, and on the whole, the participation of parents is on the low side. We would carefully review the key findings so as to enhance the LPE in schools. We would look into look in detail the whole student development plan, the LPE, and the moral educations, which should be well coordinated, and map out the road ahead. We will continue to encourage school to launch LPE under the whole school approach and to make optimum use of resources provided, and there should be more of a teacher exchange supports, and also the organizing seminars for parents. We would enhance our website to provide information on on further studies and career. The Education Bureau will continue to roll out the BSPP to promote the LPE-related culture. Chairman, in respect of the consultancy report on the review of life planning education and business school partnerships programs and the key findings and recommendations, members' comments and will be most welcome. Mr. Ao Lok Hin, Mr. Leung Yu Chong, Mrs. Regina Yip, Mr. Gary Fan, and I myself. Anyone else? All right, 4 minutes for each member. Mr. Ao Lok Hin. Undersecretary, good afternoon. It's not that we don't have adequate provision of life planning education. When a student wants to know what kind of career he wants to pursue, the major question is opportunity. For example, he wants to enter the Arts and Cultural Center. It's not going to be easy in the Hong Kong context. If you want to be a film director, well, you have a very narrow career path, even if you are an award winner. You know, to put the students of different aptitudes and abilities in the six major industries, can you really match their interest? It's questionable. Can we assign them with the right learning programs, and they have to pay tuition fees, which can be substantial, and therefore their learning opportunities are constrained by cost? The Federation of Youth has interviews young people at the age of 751 young people at the age of 12 to 21. They rank the LPE at a point of at a score of 6.1, which is just average. Well, we have a very monopolist economic structure, and therefore they find it difficult to explore their opportunities and to give their potential the full play. So would the government offer more options to students? Well, the students may want to know more about their orientation, but they will not be working upon graduation. They may need to get training, and training comes at a cost. Would the government provide more subsidies and offer more affordable training programs to them, so that they will be equipped with the right skills? And how can you promote the credibility and acceptance of the existing training programs? Undersecretary, the first question is that under LPE, the students may develop skills and understand better its own aspirations and orient aptitude, but unfortunately, the direction in the community may not be in line with his own orient needs. I hope the students can be helped in understanding the environment, and we should promote some kind of a linkage under LPE between the student and the aspiring careers and jobs that they would like to hold. So apart from knowing the one's own aspirations, we need to make sure that the other conditions are there to help them. For example, promotion of LPE and the support and understanding shown by parents to their children is an interactive process. And the government would also want to diversify our economy, and also the students should be helped in broadening their horizons so that understanding the opportunities afforded by neighboring areas. On the question of further studies, we provide vocational training and professional training
being promoted so that the students will be given more opportunities to receive a vocational and professional training. Mr. Leung Yu Chung, I think Mr. Ngao is asking whether we can give students more opportunities and not that, and their interests can be met. On May Day, I handed in a petition letter at the to the CGO together with some other people. That is on the field on of equal opportunities for the disabled. People with disability might have a completed secondary education or even tertiary education. They need to get a job. Very often, if they sit a written test, well, there's no problem. But when they're interviewed, they're not accepted. So is there any discrimination? So maybe discrimination against these people with disabilities means that they get no employment. And sometimes these people do not have the skills. And so there's no question of asking where their interests lie. Turning to LPE, many schools have turned the teaching post into a regular post responsible for LPE. But very little time is available for a student with is made available for students with SEN. So can we improve the manpower for the support under LPE to SEN student so as to offer more help to these students to get employment in the future? So we should focus not just on life planning, but also for future employment. But you have been doing a lot for mainstream students, but what about a student with disabilities and with learning difficulties? Undersecretary, the first question is about whether for SEN students we can provide more service to to students with SENs under LPE. For integrated education schools, there are dedicated people, the educational psychologists, counseling, teachers, and school social workers who work together to provide individualized support to SEN students. The support will be more intensive than that for mainstream school students. But perhaps we should look into the potential of a student with SENs more thoroughly. In schools for the visually impaired, schools for blind students, the students and teachers have been trying to afford more the employment opportunities and enhance their potential for employment by modifying the equipment that is used in the workplace. I visited some of these schools and met with the students. Well, first of all, they have to understand the constraints that they face because of disability. But with supporting measures implemented, their potential can be realized. I think with the increasing awareness on the part of the society and the employer, we will be able to do more for them. Well, the education psychologists will be focusing on learning, and it's not really the focus on life planning. So I hope you will do more by providing better service in respect of life planning and future employment. Mrs. Regina Yip, the first time I learned about this term, life planning, I find it curious because life is really uncertain. You know, it's difficult to plan over your life, over so many years. Well, when I was a civil servant, I never realized one day I'll become a legislator. I think the earlier we start with planning assistance, the better, because they need to choose, the students have to choose subjects that they pursued. And also, apart from the four compulsory DSE subjects, there's two electives. If they make the wrong choices, it will be difficult to apply for certain undergraduate courses. So the counseling should be provided to students at a younger. If you just give them $500,000 to the schools, it's just for purchasing services. And of course, elite schools enjoy the advantages. They have more the alumni who are doing well in their careers. Some benefit schools are not getting sufficient resources. I won't propose to the provision of one dedicated teacher for life planning education. In other schools, in overseas schools, that they have an entire building dedicated to the career guidance for their students. Many manpower surveys have told us that many students want to become civil servants because of the higher starting pay. It's more than $20,000 for assistant clerical officers, and there's a progression ladder that they can pursue. So would, under the BSPP, would you arrange for civil servants such as fires, officers, and transport officers to talk to the students so that they know which subjects to choose in their studies? The member is suggesting that we should provide more resources so that students understand government departments and the jobs that they have more. We have the shadow assistance, i.e., intern program for the policy secretaries. We also have thematic talks on government departments and jobs. We can arrange more talks in the schools depending on their needs on government and civil service jobs. So there's no need to worry about the lack of such talks. And apart from teachers, we have to involve alumni, school sponsoring bodies themselves, and NGOs, and professional bodies. We have 300 partners in different industries, and in the future, we can also encourage the schools to organize talks through the government departments.
Yes, I do have reservations about the program of shadowing the top secretaries, because there is such a big gap. You shadow them in the officiating ceremony, ribbon-cutting ceremony. They're not part of the confidential meetings. Perhaps you should deploy some civil servants to talk to the students at schools about the civil service career. It would be more practical. Ms. Gary Fan, I'm also concerned about the effectiveness of the LPE and how we can make improvement in the days to come. Para 8.3, the government said that the government would be able to, the students will be able to identify their interest and their orientation, and also the level of participation has scored the lowest. It means that the students are not taking part much in the programs. In the Federation of School Groups, there was a poll showing that 30% of the people polled feel that LPE doesn't help much in equipping the students with the knowledge about their career pathways. So how would the administration look at the findings of the poll? Why is it that the students are not so willing to take part in the LPE activities organized by the schools? Second, according to the paper, these BSPP partners recognize the concept, and the BSPP partners endorse this kind of program. Will the administration devote more resources to organize talks and activities in the context of BSPP cooperation? And what level of resources would there be if it is the case? Undersecretary, right about the findings of the review, we asked, we polled 150 schools in a broad spectrum of way, and there is a difference in terms of the sampling. It is only natural that we have different results. Now, the one conducted by the Education University is more comprehensive. Now, the level of participation is on the low side on the part of the students. That's because the students are rather busy in the senior secondary school life, and we will follow up with the schools to see how this can be connected with the curriculum so that the participation rate can be boosted in such a way that the students can be assisted more effectively. BSPP, it is a kind of social resources. There are 300 or so organizations that are volunteering. We allow the students to take part, and these commercial entities are offering the service for free. There may be transportation assistance that will be offered only. Mr. Fan, now the student participation is slow. You mentioned the school life is busy, and they would not have any time left for participation. Other than this reason, are there any particular reason that led to this low level of participation? Yes, in the study, they mentioned the students' opinions. Now, the talks, which are one way, without any interaction, and they're not particularly interesting, and they find that the information is not sufficient regarding career pathways, and we're encouraging the schools to engage in more interactive career pathway exploration instead of the large scale talks. They are changing the format in order to lure more students to take part, and there will also be elements of real life experience and so on. All right, it's my turn to take the floor. Now, this LPE, Mr. SHIU Ka-chun, has raised a number of questions. Mr. Gary Fan has put a question about the survey. Now, Mr. SHIU Ka-chun actually raised a similar question. I think this question is very meaningful. And he would like to have a reply in writing. I'd like to cite some of the questions. Now, this life education and life planning education, and how are they related? According to the consultant, there should be an enhancement of life education, which should form the basis. Ethics and values should be the basis for life planning education. Even if the career information is insufficient, they would have some sensible decision. They can make sensible decision if they have the backing of the ethics and values. But if the ethics and values are suspect, then the life planning education would be on shaky ground. So Mr. Shu Ka-chun would like to ask, to what extent will life education be given a role in the process of life planning education? I'd like to extend the question by saying that in terms of life planning education, increasingly, we have life planning education sessions taking up a lot more of the classroom hours. It's good to pursue this idea, but the students are running short of time. For the 8 universities and overseas, they do have the further education counseling. And they also have career counseling in schools. Mr. Gary Fan mentioned the busy school life. Now, how are we going to do the trade-off in the senior secondary school life? Life planning education is something that we'd like to do more of. But would there be any constraint there, time-wise? And will the other secretary address this question together with the element of life education? All right, for the first question by Mr. Shu Ka-chun, raised by the chairman on his behalf. As chairman said, life education will form the basis. So understanding of one's interest and orientation, this is part of the life education, the purpose of life, the meaning of life, and so on, would form part of the life education. It would be hard for us to segregate the two. The whole spirit is to tie in with the school education and at different stages of the student's life. We are guiding the students to think about their future. We don't have any target or any statistical target there. As to the classroom hours, Madam Ip made the point. We agree that quality is far more important than quantity because of the busy schedule. So whether we're talking about further education or career pathways, we will focus our attention on the quality of the activities. And this is really the focus of life planning education going forward. 4 minutes for Dr. An Zheng. Chairman, life planning education has been going on for some years now. We gave our support at that time because we felt that young people should start learning about society in their younger days, and as they grow up, they should try to understand their interests, their desire, and also their orientation when making decisions. When they move into universities, they should know what subject they should take up. The most important thing is what opportunities are lying ahead for them. They may be interested in certain things. By the time they graduate in 5-4 years' time, the market might have undergone considerable changes. Now, AI is the order of the day, and the whole society is undergoing transformation, and there are many jobs that will not be undertaken by human beings. So I'm wondering whether we can collect more information for the students in their career exploration. I think the missing link with regard to life planning education is this. And para 36 of the paper indicates that the students are aware of the importance, but the participation is very low. Now, there is a lowest score regarding students' participation in life planning activities. Now, why is that the case? This is very important. What actually happened? Is it because there is no fun to it in the eyes of the students? Are they boring in the eyes of the students? Can you give us more information, please? Undersecretary? Right, the first question about life planning education, is there any lack of elements about the rapidly changing society and how the students should equip themselves? Now, in our courses, in our interaction with the international community, we are also looking at this AI era and also the demand that will be created of the students. In our review exercise, we would cover this in our review exercise, and we're going to be making a report to members in this regard. Second, the low participation rate. As we said a moment ago, the students in senior secondary education is are very busy, and sometimes the activities would be in the form of a one-way dissemination of messages, and this can be rather boring. And we are trying to focus more attention on the real-life experience, more exploration kind of activities. So instead of aiming for quantity, we are aiming for quality in order to enhance the participation rate and achieve more effective results. Make it brief, please. Chairman, we went to Germany for a duty visit. We also looked at the life planning education. In our contact with the students, they are really excited, and they are able to be exposed to different careers. Now, there was one who changed his jobs many times, and he ended up being a draftsman. And I think given opportunities to try, they will be able to find what they really want.
I think
they can get some inspiration through such activities. If you have a large-scale function and you are there listening to the instructions from senior officials, of course, they will not be interested. I won't be interested. And now, since this is welcomed by parents, students, and teachers, and even the PTU welcomes this because more teachers' posts will be created. So I hope we can do more and do better in due course. All right, that concludes this item. The next item is about library extension and revitalization of the Hong Kong Polytechnic University. Please invite the attendees to join us now. Members, if you have, if you want to raise questions, please raise your hands.
they want to give us a presentation. We may to extend the meeting time beyond 1 p.m. I would use my discretion to extend the meeting time by not more than 15 minutes. Members, please be reminded that this item is related to a funding application. In the middle of 2019, the administration will submit the item to the PWSC and then subsequently to the FC for funding approval. If you have direct or indirect pecuniary interest related to the item, please disclose the nature of your interest before you speak. Over to Dr. Choi for a brief introduction. And you may wish to use the projector if you find it appropriate. Well, we want to carry out a project to construct an additional floor on top of the University Library at Hong Kong Poly U and revitalize the existing floors. This will turn the existing library into a modern learning facility. There will be an additional floor with an additional provision of 2,080 square meters in net operational floor area, and the existing floor will be revitalized. There will be the new space we use for collaborative learning, quiet study, presentation forum, and IT workstation areas. There are other learning facilities. There will be more washrooms, and new lifts will be provided at money of the day's basis. The estimated cost is $346.1 million. I hope this project can be supported by the panel so that we can submit the item to the PWSC and the FC for funding approval in mid-2019, so the work can commence in the third quarter this year for completion in the fourth quarter of 2022. And I'll defer to the Polytechnic University's representative for details of the works. Good afternoon, Chairman and members. The Undersecretary has told you that this is a project for the extension of the Hong Kong Polytechnic University Library. I think you're familiar with the location. This is the library marked in red. It's opposite to the railway station. You would see the library once you have you left the footbridge. This is the sectional drawing. On the sixth floor, we'll build the additional, on top of that, we'll build an additional floor. And there will be conversion to the existing floors for the collaborative learning and quiet study to cope with the changes in the learning mode. And there will be additional lifts and washrooms. And we need to refurbish the toilets which have been used for many years. And some modification will also be carried out. As the Undersecretary has said, we want to do this to tie in with the new academic study, the 334 studies, and the increase in the student population. We've so far not carried out any major conversion and extension projects. This project will result in additional space for learning for our students. This is our architect's artist impression. This is a view from across the Cross Harbour Tunnel. So there will be additional floor on top of the sixth floor. And this is the view from a garden inside the university. This is the platform where we have a lot of students. And this is the main entrance that we are seeing here. Here will be the new entrance. And then you can see the additional floor on the top. As for the estimated cost and the timetable, if this is endorsed by members today, next month we will submit an item to the PWSC for approval, and then we will proceed to the Finance Committee for funding approval. We hope to start the project in the third quarter or during the summer vacation if we can. The entire project will be completed in the fourth quarter of 2022. Thank you. All right, Ms. Ann Zhang and Deputy Chairman will speak, and I will also speak. So there are three of us. 3 minutes. Ms. Ann Zhang, Chairman, we need to revitalize the library, which is old. There are more electronic equipment and systems, such as borrowing system or appointment system. And I've heard about delivery systems for books that you'd have chosen to borrow through an electronic platform. My question is about the changes that can be brought by this revitalization project in terms of electronic equipment. Maybe I can say something about this. I'm the university library. We're going to turn our publications into and books into electronic format. 99% of our journal will be e-journals, and 78% of our books are e-books. But we need a lot of physical space. And in the past year, the 2.8 million users of the library were recorded. We have a lot of electronic equipment, our computer system are linked to the project rooms for students. Booking can be made through the internet platform, and there will be a new RFID system for automated borrowing and returning of books. How much will this cost? It's on the screen. What's the cost involved? $340 million.
想咧就假如係咁，佢哋其實都要再要去財委會度攞錢噶嘛，係咪？咁我好希望
going to go to the FC for funding approval, right? So more information on the electronics base services should be provided. You are going to get funds for this, so you should go for electronic systems and upgrade your systems, and please provide all the details to the Finance Committee. Deputy Chairman, the university library is an important infrastructure for any university. So we, of course, we support an extension project for the PolyU. But the paper is rather short and succinct, but we will be talking about a large amount of funds to be provided. And some universities would do more to provide more interaction and communication through the the libraries, but not very little is mentioned in this paper. Can you tell us more about what the upgraded library will be offering in terms of facilities? Are there any other ideas that you would like to take forward? And how about the number of books? We are told that there will be more public space, new space will be provided. But what about the collections that you are going to have? Are you going to increase the collections? I would ask my colleagues from the PolyU to respond to the question. First of all, thank you for your questions, Deputy Chairman. When it comes to the project, we are going to have built an additional floor that would take up half of the estimated cost of the project. It would give us additional space, quite a lot of additional space of 2,000 square meters. So the more facilities can be housed. For example, for the sharing sessions between the authors and students. But in the past, libraries ask all its users to be quiet, and everyone there should remain silent. There will be changes in the way learning is done. I would defer to the university librarian for more details on the facilities. We are going to have recording studios with good sound insulation because we want our students to learn to express themselves through video media. And they would do some video conferencing with overseas students and universities, and there will be a display area for student productions. We use the studios, the students would use the studios to reflect on what they have learned. These are some of the facilities. I visited a secondary school the other day. They have modified their library. It's not like having just a desk and some chairs. It's just like a coffee shop setting. They provide a space for more interactive activities. 30% of the seats will be for collaborative activities. It's not like the ordinary setting of a long desk with many chairs. There will be whiteboards for students, and screens will be there for PowerPoint presentation. And the files can be shared through such screens. Such facility would take up 30% of the total.
Collaboration would be very important. All right, it's my turn now, and then Dr. Helena Wong. My question is similar to the vice chair's. This paper is rather flimsy, and you said you've had a number of meetings and sharing sessions to listen to the students and teachers' views. Now, if you've done the sharing session, I'm sure you must have a lot more information to share with us. I think when presenting the paper, the Education Bureau should play the gatekeeping role, because the PolyU may not be aware of what we need. I think the Bureau should have done something to make sure that the paper is of substantial content. Like in the extension area, the information was given in the PowerPoint presentation, although the paper is silent on the details. Now, there is going to be an additional floor. The loading should be able to cope, or is it? Is it going to be able to cope? Second, in the course of building the additional floor, will the existing operation of the library be in any way affected? Will there be any disruption? Will there be any suspension of service? And how long is it going to be for? Chairman, if I may take the first part of the question. In relation to the further details, we are prepared to supplement further information. I heard what members have to say. Second, the floor loading, it has been recognized by the APs that the floor loading would be sufficient for an additional floor and the greening features. And I can defer to the PolyU for further details. In terms of operation, having regard to the fact that the PolyU library has a pretty high utilization rate on an annual basis, and in the course of work, we'll make sure that the library will be opened as usual. There will be noise enclosure and noise mitigation measures, and there may be floor-by-floor renovation work so that the users will not be in any way affected by this renovation and extension work. So so much for my reply in brief. Dr. Helena Wong and Dr. Ching Chung Tai, I'm going to draw a line there. Dr. Wong, please. Chairman, I must make a declaration. I'm a lecturer of PolyU. I'm going to proceed to retirement on the 30th of June. However, I can still go back and borrow books. I support this project. About the floor loading, now we are going to have an additional floor on top. Would that be enough? Looking ahead into the future, the PolyU will be here to stay and there will be more student population. Will one additional floor be quite enough? Are you going to need two additional floors? Will the loading be sufficient? I think that the architects were really smart. They must have anticipated additional floors. I don't know, will this extension be enough to cope with 10 more years or what? Undersecretary, well, I did put similar questions. They would look at the foundation in looking at the loading, and that's the maximum that we can achieve. So at the present moment, that's as far as we can go. Second, like the university library and the other representatives said, as we go ahead with digitalization, all the facilities will be upgraded in addition to the extension. We're going to have digital books and versus physical books, and this will be able to address the need in the near term. Will you come back to us for an additional floor? The loading would be hitting the maximum. Yes, right. I defer to the PolyU. Oh, if I may ask a question about the roof garden, would there be a roof garden on top? Who will gain access to the garden? Well, this will not be open to the students. The library is at a lower level than the neighboring buildings, and we are responding to the government's greening proposal. So we're not opening these to the students. It's just a greening feature. It will not be accessible to students. Will it be designed in such a way that it will be accessible to the students? I'm sure that the Department of U has taken this into account. Chairman, thank you. Thanks very much, Dr. Wong, for the good ideas. Now, we have thought about it. As we said, we have taken into account the loading, and we have hit the maximum, and we need to have a life load element if we allow access to the students. At the present moment, we're just providing the green feature without any access. Right, that's a technical question. Dr. Ching Chung Tai, Chairman, thank you. Now, with an additional floor, the PolyU library isn't that high, and people tend to be walking up and down the library. You have two small elevators. With an additional floor, you have altogether 8 floors. Now, it begs 2 questions. In the course of work, what arrangement would that be for the existing 2 lifts? And second, what about the students with SEN? I mean, the number of students with special needs has been increasing. With an additional floor, would they have to wait for an awful long time for the lift service? Undersecretary? Yes, the lift will be incorporated into the renovation project. That the member asked the question about the arrangement of lift service in the course of work. I defer to the Department of U. Thank you. There are 3 lifts serving the library. They will be renovated. As time goes by, we're going to be renovating them to increase the speed and capacity. Now we have a platform going up and down. Now from the platform to going up to the roof, one will have to go up 3 or 4 floors, and we don't expect too many difficulties going up to the top floors. In the course of work, the 3 lifts will not be used for transportation of materials. Of course, we will stop the lift for replacement, but we will do this on a phased basis in order to minimize the disruption to the students. I'm wondering whether the librarian has anything to add. I must emphasize that the library will be open as usual. The lifts will undergo renovation at different times. Any one time, we will allow only 1 lift for renovation. Dr. Cheng, when you take this to the FC, I'm wondering whether you have anything to add. There are some problems here. Now, PolyU offers more self-financing courses, and the library will be serving all kinds of students. And there were some different expectations, different from the UGCs. Maybe we cannot have enough time to go into detail, but certainly this would be discussed at the FC. But will you address the question in brief, please? Because the PwC might say that this falls outside the area. I defer to the UGC. Thank you. Thanks very much. I'm Dr. Cheng. Well, the UGC has always had the arrangement whereby certain activities would be funded by the UGC and certain self-financing courses will not be funded by the UGC. For library, we require them to split up the utilization, and a report has to be submitted by the PolyU. And the university has to retain an auditor to look at the account, and the chairman of the university will have to sign on the documentation to verify the validity of the split. we are not going to issue any new guidelines in relation to this renovation project. We will stick with the existing guidelines. Right, about the lifts, according to the paper, there will be additional lifts. Will there be three as a result of the renovation, or do you maintain the three? Yes, we maintain the three. There will be no new lifts, are there? Yes, they will go further up. They will not go further up. There is a new lift will be provided. From this, we take it to mean that there will be additional lifts to be provided. Perhaps the phraseology might be a little bit suspect. As some members said, the paper is silent on the details, and the paper will be submitted to the PWSC and the Finance Committee for discussion. I hope that the Bureau and the University will enrich the content. You mentioned the green features on the rooftop. The paper is completely silent on this. Now, this is an important element when it comes to the PWSC. So I hope that the Bureau and the University would pay attention to this. Well, this will go to the PWSC. I hope that the green features on the rooftop, you might wish to make available the details from the buildings department. Now, after the CTU's collapse, I'm sure a lot of members will be asking a question about the loading, right, about the lifts. Now, the paper meant for LegCo will be binding. If you've got it wrong, there may be some liabilities. So I hope that you would make sure that it is absolutely correct. I'd like to gauge members, and do you support the idea of submitting this to the PWSC? Any objection there? No objection? Right, so this will be submitted to the PWSC. In the meantime, we hope that the Bureau and the University will supplement further details. Unless you have anything else, this meeting is now adjourned. Thank you all very much.